Well, hello. It's Sunday afternoon, and that means it's time for the Money Show. And we will talk in this show about money, the economy, your investments, anything having to do with money. And you can join the fun by calling 1-800-259-9231. That's 1-800-259-9231. Or you can email me. The address is question@harrybrown.org. And that's my name. Yes, Joe Question. No. My name is Harry Brown. And I will be your host for this hour as we talk about money, the economy, investments, anything having to do with money. And I thought that we might begin today by talking about the difference between talent and skill, because there's a great deal of confusion about this. People are led to believe that they can acquire a great talent. And it isn't just for investing or speculating. It might be for playing the piano or painting or anything else. And there is a difference between talent and skill. Skill is something you acquire. Talent is something that you have. And in every area of our lives, we recognize the importance of talent. We know that there are musicians, athletes, comics, writers, artists, architects, actors, orators, people whose abilities go far beyond what they've learned from schooling or from experience. And this is true not only in glamorous occupations. We see the special brilliance that some people have as cooks or flower arrangers or woodworkers, mechanics, hairdressers. You undoubtedly know somebody who has an unusually good memory, or who is, as they say, good with his hands, or has an unusual ability to draw pictures or just add large numbers in his head. In each of these cases, the special ingredient that sets the person apart is a talent for a particular task, a talent that we say the person comes by naturally. So, mindful of the importance of talent, you wouldn't expect to become a celebrated pianist just by reading a book by Van Cliburn, Liberace, or Jerry Lee Lewis. In fact, you know that years of study with a great pianist might not turn you into even a professional pianist, or even a very good amateur. The critical question is whether you have a talent for music in general, and for the piano in particular. Talent is a factor in any job, in any craft, in any art, or even in any hobby. You probably could learn to type 50 words a minute. But no matter how smart you are or how long you practice, you might never catch up with the talented typist who can type, say, 100 words a minute. Whatever degree of talent you have for something, training can make the talent more effective, but no amount of training is going to increase your talent or enable you to achieve things that your talents just simply don't call for. Now, no one doubts this when the subject is music or athletes, yet when the subject is investing, this point is overlooked, and we continually hear that you can be a great speculator. But talent is just as critical a factor in the investment world. Some people were born to be speculators. And some speculators wish they'd never been born. Writers and advisors will tempt you with the idea that you could become a great speculator, another Bernard Baruch, a millionaire many times over, just by practicing the rules followed by the great speculators of all time, even though the person suggesting all this probably hasn't accomplished it himself. It's a wonderful idea, but it just doesn't make sense. Think about it. Would you expect to make it to the stage of the Metropolitan Opera just by reading a book called Luciano's Favorite Singing Tricks? Would you expect to become an inventive genius like Thomas Edison just by watching an old Mickey Rooney movie? Why should it be plausible or even possible that you, as well as millions of other investors who receive the same advertisements, could become a stock market whiz just by learning the tricks of a recognized genius. Many elements of investing and even speculating can be learned, and they can be put to use profitably without any special talent. But beyond these techniques lies an art that can't be taught or captured in a list of rules. An art requires talent that no effort or education can produce. Some people study painting for years, but never paint anything that you'd want to look at. Others fill their school days with math courses, but they're never really at home with even elementary algebra. And many people learn all that they can about investing and speculating, but they still seem to buy the wrong things time after time after time. Apart from those who have simply been lucky, the people who achieve spectacular speculative success do so because they have a talent for speculating. Some of these winners are unrealistic, unattractive, even unintelligent people, but they have a talent for sensing the movements of markets. Now, talent isn't everything. Because of other factors, some talented people are more successful than others. And the lack of a natural talent for speculating doesn't leave you helpless. But any plans you may have to become a star speculator are empty if they disregard the importance of a natural talent. And people who tell you that you can learn to spot changes in the market and that you can learn how to chart and from the charts divine the movements of the market are really simply selling you a bill of goods. They may or may not be successful in the marketplace themselves. But even if they are successful, they are not going to be able to pass that talent on to you. All they can do is to pass a few rules that might help you if you do have a talent. Not only is it impossible to copy the tricks of someone whose talents are different from yours, sometimes it's even difficult to identify what those tricks are. Very, very few geniuses can explain their gifts. And the reason for that is because they do so little that is based solely on explicit step-by-step reasoning. Now, this is true, of course, for most of what anybody does. For example, when you drive a car, you don't say to yourself, now I'll turn the wheel slightly to the left, now I'll turn it slightly to the right, now I should shift gears. Nor do you explain to yourself why you're doing each of these things. You act automatically because your mind is taking in and processing information about the road, about the traffic, about the speed and direction of your car, all without you having to make conscious decisions. In fact, if a passenger asked you why you did a particular thing, you might find it very difficult to explain. You might not even have noticed that you did it. When you make decisions without noticing the step-by-step process, you're using intuition, which is the unconscious processing of information and ideas. And we'll talk a little bit more about intuition, especially in investing and speculating. When we come back, the phone number is 1-800-259-9231, and this is Harry Brown. This is Harry Brown. My book, Fail-Safe Investing, will tell you what you need to know to create your own bulletproof investment portfolio, one that will protect you whatever the future brings, prosperity, inflation, recession, even depression, and it will protect you without your having to predict the future or tinker with the portfolio. Best news of all, at libertyfree.com, you can download the book for only $9.75. That's right, just $9.75. You can read the book on your computer screen or print it out and read it in your easy chair. If you're tired of losing money on your investments, tired of the pressure of looking for the best investments, Here's the way to have your own bulletproof portfolio, no matter how big or small your savings. To get a free sample chapter from Failsafe Investing, just go to libertyfree.com right now. That's libertyfree.com. Welcome back. That happy music tells us that it's a good world we live in, and that whatever the problem is, whether it has to do with money or anything else, there's probably a solution somewhere, so let's find it. We have some emails coming in, and I will get to those very, very soon, but I do want to just finish my thoughts here on the tricks of speculating as versus the tricks of conscious investing. And there is a difference. Investing is when you simply try to achieve the results that are available to everybody in the market by putting your money in places where you somewhat know what the results should be. And speculating is when you try to do much, much better than average. And as I said, when you make decisions without noticing the step-by-step process, you're using intuition, which is the unconscious processing of information and of ideas. You use intuition when you sell a car. It's sell a car when you drive a car. When you do most daily rote tasks. There's nothing otherworldly about intuition. It's not a strange gift for divining the future or even for reading minds. It's simply a faculty that everyone has to make a judgment, right or wrong, without paying attention to how you make the judgment. When intuition operates, you analyze information and ideas without noticing the process until the answer pops to the surface of your mind. With intuition, you size up a stranger as being honest or dishonest, or judge whether a house is one that you'd be happy living in without identifying all the factors that influence your decision. And in fact, most everyday activities run on intuition. You eat, walk, write, talk. Most physical labor and a great deal of mental labor all are done through intuition. You don't focus on each step as you go along. You don't say, now I'm going to do this, now I'm going to do that. You just move. And, of course, habit is also involved in many activities, but habit and intuition aren't quite the same thing. Intuition is an activity of your intellect, a way by which you form judgments and opinions about what is true or, say, what you're going to do in a particular situation. But habit, on the other hand, is a condition that allows you to do repetitive things easily. Intuition is a natural function, but habit is wholly learned. And, of course, can be unlearned. Now, a speculator acts intuitively also. He buys when he senses that he should. Perhaps his intuition has noticed a critical similarity between current market conditions and earlier situations that he doesn't explicitly remember, but that those earlier situations proved to be profitable. Or he may decide against an investment because he unconsciously detects a hazard that makes him feel uneasy about it, a hazard that others haven't noticed. Now, if you ask him how he made his decision, he probably isn't going to say, it just felt right to me, even though that might be the most accurate answer. Most likely, he'll cite a half dozen economic factors or technical indicators to explain his judgment, even though he didn't think of those things before he made his decision. And it's unlikely that those were the deciding factors. For one thing, there were similar indicators that may have pointed in the opposite direction. Now, what he cites as his reasons may be important, but his final decision was intuitive. A feeling based upon his past experience, a feeling that made him think that now is the time to buy or not to buy. And so he can't give you a complete explanation. However, the fact that he can't explain his actions doesn't mean he didn't have good reasons for what he did. Speculative talent operates intuitively for the most part. and it draws on experience, which provides a fund of information to which intuition can refer. Financial experience isn't the only kind that serves you. When you make investment decisions, you draw upon what you know about human nature, on what life has taught you about making decisions, on what you've found to be logical or silly, careful or careless, on your ability to evaluate people's opinions and arguments, on your memories of how fads and fashions have changed, and on thousands of facts of life that go into making an intuitive decision at the time you're trying to decide whether to make this speculation or not make it. Experience of almost any kind contributes to your ability to make good intuitive decisions. Now, intuition has acquired a bad name, in part because many people try to dignify what are just mere out-of-the-blue guesses, hopes and wishes. They cite the authority of their instincts or their gut feelings. You can't convert a bad investment decision into a good one or succeed with a sloppy strategy just by saying your gut feelings are telling you to do something. Intuition is valuable, and it should always be respected, but it's no better than your talent, your intelligence, and your experience. You can't just pull something out of the air and say that this is what your intuition or your gut feeling is telling you. It simply doesn't have the power to overrule reality. And in any conflict between feelings and logic, you always should let logic prevail. And that's true in any situation in life. Now, my purpose in discussing intuition isn't to encourage you to disregard logic by any means. My only purpose is to explain why it is that some people succeed in investing or speculating without being able to give satisfactory reasons for their successes. And it also means that we should be very skeptical of what people tell us as being the reason for their success. Because if you ask a successful speculator how he did it, in a lot of cases, he's simply going to make up reasons because he doesn't really fully understand what he has done. He may have a natural talent for speculating, which, because he doesn't have a terribly logical brain, makes it impossible for him to define and explain exactly why he knew to buy this and not to buy that. And he can't pass that intuitive talent on to you. He can only tell you what he knows logically, and that may not be transferable to you in order for you to be able to do the same thing he does. So be very wary of people, even people who have a proven record of success, telling you, here's how you're going to become a successful speculator. We'll be back in just a couple of minutes. The phone number is 1-800-259-9231 if you have a question. This is Harry Brown. This is Harry Brown. Have you lost money in stocks over the past few years? From 2000 through 2002, the stock market lost a third of its value. But during those 3 years, a bulletproof portfolio gained 9%. And over the past 34 years, such a portfolio gained an average of over 9% per year throughout periods of prosperity, inflation, and recession, with no wide swings in value. My book, Failsafe Investing, shows how you can have that kind of portfolio for yourself. And now you can download the book for only $9.75. You don't have to rely on alleged market wizards or stay up late worrying about your savings. Failsafe Investing will show you how to have the security that you crave. Go to libertyfree.com to see a sample chapter of Failsafe Investing, and then start protecting the savings you've worked so hard to acquire. That's libertyfree.com. All right. We'll take some email questions that have come in just a minute. But first, we have a caller on the line. So let's go to Los Angeles, California, and talk with Olivier. I'm sorry, I don't have your name right, do I?
Yes, it's Laurence Olivier. So
Olivier.
Yep.
Oh, but spelled like Oliver.
No, spelled like Olivier. O-L-I-V-I-E-R.
Ah, yes. Okay. All right. I'm sorry. My French ain't too good.
Okay.
What's up today?
Well, a couple of weeks ago, there was a fellow who asked very interesting questions about the permanent portfolio, and that I thought I had understood everything, and now I'm back with some more questions about it. It's about mostly the gold portion.
Sure.
What if we find ourselves in a bull market and gold shoots up like it did in the 70s? From 30 to 800. Now, depending on how fast you would rebalance your permanent portfolio, that would amount to speculating. If you kept, for example, the gold portfolio, the gold part growing to a larger amount than if you were instantly rebalancing all the time.
All right.
How would you deal with that?
Well, my suggestion is, of course, that you start by having 25% in each of stocks, bonds, gold, and cash. And the idea is that you should rebalance any time the portfolio reaches the point where one investment has risen to 35% of the total or down to 15%. And normally, you would just check this, you know, once a year. But sometimes you are aware that a market is going wild, and if that gold rise that you spoke of was very spectacular and very quick, as it was in the late 1970s, then you would want to make it a point to check the percentages in the portfolio and see how unbalanced they have become, maybe even every month if there were a wild speculative spree going on. Normally, you'd check it once a year, but if something wild was like that was going on and you were aware of it, then when the gold got to be 35% of the total value of the portfolio, then you would want to sell enough to bring it back to 25% and use the proceeds to bring other of the investments up to 25%. Have I misunderstood the question?
No, it's a perfect. It's just that sometimes practically it is more difficult to save gold that is physically in safe deposit box, and so to do it frequently in the case of a spectacular rise would be
It is very, very rare that anything reaches 35%, but it can happen during a big run-up like we had in 1979 in gold, when gold finally peaked at $800 in January of 1980. And in a case like that, you probably would only rebalance once during that run-up, but it might happen twice, but I would think it would only be once you would get back to 25%, and then by the time it could get to 35% again, the run would probably be over, because those things can't go on for two or three years in a row. Not that kind of spectacular rise where something is even doubling in a year.
And the dealers are by law required to file some report to the IRS or some federal agencies to comply with taxing requirements. Or when I would be selling, for example, the gold in that case.
I don't believe so. Am I missing something? Are you aware of something I'm not? Which is not impossible, by the way.
Well, My intuition or what I've heard is that you have to report any time you sell gold.
I don't believe that's true, but it would be true if you sold a great amount of it.
Okay.
I would think that a gold dealer would then file a report, even if it weren't as much as what the minimum for a report is required. But if it just seemed like an unusual amount, he probably would, just to play it safe with the authorities.
And a closely related question is, when and why did the governments of several countries, a few years ago, it seems, start to mint those gold coins again?
Well, I think partly because there was a great demand for it. Ever since the 1970s, there has been a much greater demand worldwide for gold by private investors than there was before, and countries have wanted, governments have wanted to get in on the action.
Because
they do sell them initially at a premium. The premium is so small that we don't have to worry about it, but it means money to them, and it means prestige also to have an Austrian Philharmonic coin circulating around the world, you know, that sort of thing.
And once it would be really interesting if you had the time in one of your shows to speak about something you touched on recently about smaller hard currency quantities that people could use in case of they want to, you know, use that currency instead of paper currency.
Well, I would think that in most cases that currency would not be very valuable to you because it would not be recognized and accepted as purchasing media in the United States. But if you're talking about doing a lot of traveling around the world, then of course it wouldn't hurt to have small supplies of the currency of the countries you're likely to be in, because it might serve you in an event when the banks might be closed there or some other very, very rare emergency, but where you're unable to get money wired to you or something else. But I may be missing the question here.
Yeah, a couple of weeks ago you talked about in a state of emergency in a country where the current currency is unusable, people don't want to get out their American Eagle out of the safe deposit box and start to buy Wonder Bread with it. They want to use some smaller units. And you mentioned that there were some old coins in the U.S. system that could fulfill that purpose.
Oh, I see. Well, yes, I was talking about the silver coins up to, my gosh, 1964. It's been a long, long time. And I hate to say I remember when this happened, but I do. In 1964, the federal government in the United States decided not to put silver in the coins anymore. Up to that time, the dimes and quarters and half dollars had 90% silver in them, and the silver dollars had 95% silver in them. And then starting in 1965, they had no silver whatsoever. They are copper nickel. And if you put a 1964 or earlier quarter next to one from 1965 or later, you can see the difference in the color.
Wow.
And you can see that one is silver and the other is tarnished, in effect, or diluted with this copper nickel. Well, it's not even diluted. It is copper nickel. So the point is that it was thought that those older coins would be useful as trading mechanisms. The problem is that we are now so far away from that time of 1964, we're talking about a period 40 years ago, that most people who are alive today have no understanding, knowledge whatsoever of the difference between post-1964 coins and coins that pre-1965. So if you said to somebody, I've got these real quarters, real half dollars, real dimes that are real silver, I'm not so sure they would be recognized anymore. I'll give you one more thought about that when we come back, Olivier, so you might want to stay on the line. This is Harry Brown. I can take your question, or try to, if you call 1-800-259-9231. We will be right back. Well, welcome back. This is Harry Brown, and we're talking with Olivier on the phone. He's in California, and he asked about the use of junk silver, as it used to be called. Junk silver, meaning that it had no numismatic value, but it was coins that were actually minted with silver, a practice the government stopped in 1965 and started issuing the coins that are made of copper and nickel that we have now. And I really believe that we are so far away from those silver coins that they are not going to be recognized as being particularly valuable by people in the case of a real emergency, of a breakdown of the banking system or something else. But I don't think it would hurt to have $100 or so of those real silver coins, in other words, 1964 or earlier, dimes, quarters, or half dollars. It wouldn't hurt to have $100 or so of those in a safe deposit box or hid somewhere safely at home. But I would not expect that to be highly usable, but you never know. It might also be useful if you're afraid of the possibility of a complete breakdown of the money system to have in your possession certain goods that you think might be easily barterable, that somebody would be glad to accept in exchange for some service. They might be canned goods or other goods that have an unusually long shelf life or something of that sort. But of course, we're talking here about, you know, the really direst situation that might exist where the currency itself breaks down in this country. And that's not impossible. And I do not consider it alarmist to protect against it, but I would not bend my life out of shape doing it. I would just make sure that I have a few things that might be useful in the event of such an emergency. Am I helping you any at all, Olivia?
Yeah, absolutely. Has anybody ever asked you why you chose 25% for each of these investment categories?
Oh, my Ouija board told me to do it. No, actually, that's a very good question, because there is no magic formula. And I gave a great deal of thought to this, and there is nothing you can do to devise a scientific formula for this. You can go back and look at the past, but all you're doing is looking at this situation or that situation or some other situation. And in fact, if you were going to take the last 40 or 50 years as a guide, you would put 100% in one particular investment, whatever happened to be the best one of the last 40 or 50 years. But that would not have helped you during the time when maybe that one investment was going down for 4 or 5 years in a row, and you needed to have purchasing power during that time, and your investments were losing. So after a great deal of thought, I just simply came to the conclusion that the best thing was to just split it across the board four ways. And if somebody was determined to do it another way, I would have no scientific argument. But I would say this, that if you just are basing your divisions on what you think that the next few years are going to bring, then you don't have a permanent portfolio. You have a speculative portfolio, one in which you are trying to outguess the future. But if you look at it and you say, well, historically, this, that, and the other thing, I've come to the conclusion that maybe I should have 30% in this and 20% in that, there's not a lot I could argue with you on. But I feel, I guess, that because there is no scientific basis for getting those numbers, it is best to make them even across the board, four ways at 25% each, rather than trying to say, well, this one ought to have 30 or this one ought to have 20. So there's the scientific answer to your question, Olivia.
Oh, sure, that's really good. All right.
All right. Thanks so much for calling. I'm glad to hear from you. Very good questions that I think a lot of people are going to have on their mind about setting up their own permanent portfolio. Two people have emailed me today and demonstrated their superior knowledge of current events by saying, as Kelly said in Portland, I've heard the Treasury will begin to issue new 30-year bonds. Would this be good to buy for the permanent portfolio? And she demonstrates her superior knowledge. I'm saying that facetiously, because I didn't realize, I had not heard that the Treasury's going to issue 30-year bonds. And during the last break, I took a look on the Wall Street Journal website trying to search for an article on this, and I did not find one, so I'll look again in the next break. But if that's the case, if the Treasury is going to issue 30-year bonds, then yes, that's exactly what you should have for the bond portion of the permanent portfolio, is the longest bond possible, 30 years, because you want that bond portion to have the strength to carry the whole portfolio if it ever became necessary to do so, because only bonds were doing well, which would be the case during a deflation. Bonds also do well during a period of prosperity. Stocks are also doing well then, so you get a double dose during a prosperous period. You get a bull market in stocks and a bull market in bonds as interest rates are falling. But you want the bonds to be as powerful as possible, and that's why you would like the 30-year bonds. And when if you buy 30-year bonds, when they get down to having only 20 years to maturity, then you sell them and replace them with new 30-year bonds, because the longer the bond, the greater the effect a change in interest rates has on the price of the bond. We'll continue right after this break. This is Harry Brown. Thank you for staying aboard. This is Harry Brown. My book, Fail-Safe Investing, will tell you what you need to know to create your own bulletproof investment portfolio, one that will protect you whatever the future brings, prosperity, inflation, recession, even depression. And it will protect you without your having to predict the future or tinker with the portfolio. Best news of all, at LibertyFree.com, you can download the book for only $9.75. That's right, just $9.75. You can read the book on your computer screen or print it out and read it in your easy chair. If you're tired of losing money on your investments, tired of the pressure of looking for the best investments, here's the way to have your own bulletproof portfolio, no matter how big or small your savings. To get a free sample chapter from Fail-Safe Investing, just go to LibertyFree.com right now. That's LibertyFree.com. Welcome back. This is Harry Brown, and this is the Sunday Afternoon Money Talk program, brought to you in part by the Permanent Portfolio Family of Funds, seeking safety and stability, a fund that diversifies fully so that it can seek to protect you in any economic environment. Kelly also asked in her question, has the U.S. government ever defaulted on its bonds? Not since the Revolutionary War, when the Continentals were issued. They were bonds issued by the government, they just could not meet all the obligations. But once the actual U.S. government was formed, I should say by the Revolutionary government, and once the U.S. government was formed, ever since then, it has been no problem to pay off all the bonds, because they do it just by issuing new bonds. And if they couldn't issue new bonds, they'd do it by issuing money. And so bonds and bills of the federal government, the Treasury bonds and bills, are the safest possible debt instrument that you can acquire in terms of the absence of default possibilities. But that doesn't mean the bond can't go way down in value if the federal government issued too many of them. So that's why we have some short-term, some long-term in the permanent portfolio mix. The four-way portfolio that I recommend, which is 25% each in stocks, long-term bonds, short-term treasury bills and notes, and physical gold. Those are the four things: stocks, bonds, gold, and cash, in other words. Bob asks, what are your thoughts regarding long-term care insurance? That is the type of insurance that pays for in-home care in case you become disabled and are not able to get out of bed by yourself, need help going to the bathroom, or come down with Alzheimer's disease, for example. Well, long-term care insurance is, I think, a very good idea if people can afford it. I can't even give you offhand examples of the prices that you must pay, because I don't have them in front of me, but it is something worth looking into if you have the fear that you may be dependent upon other people to take care of you, and you don't have people in your family that might be able to do it and would want to do it. So it is an option to look into. Tom in Colorado said, on your March 6th radio program, you spoke highly of one ETF fund as suitable for the bond portion of your permanent portfolio. This fund was the iShares Lehman 20-plus year Treasury bond fund. I was wondering if an ETF fund might also work for the gold portion of the permanent portfolio. And he mentions a couple of them, but they are not going to work because gold is the last resort in a very, very difficult situation that might arise, and you wouldn't want to depend upon a third party making good on it. My gosh, that music means we're out of time. I really appreciate your tuning in today, and if I didn't get to your question today, I'll save it for next week. This is Harry Brown. This has been The Money Show, brought to you in part by the Permanent Portfolio Family of Funds. I sure do appreciate your tuning in, and I'll be back next week, so come back. You hear? Come back.
Come back. Come back, sweet papa.